there. Welcome to the Race Notebook for the 2020 Turkish Grand Prix. And we have a sort of wet afternoon that reminds me of Belgium 2004. Now, the reason I say Belgium 2004 is because that was the day that Michael Schumacher scored his seventh World Championship, World Drivers' Championship, of course, before Fernando Alonso took over in 2005 and 2006. Kimi Raikkonen won in 2007. And then Lewis Hamilton won in 2008, Jensen Button in 2009, and the rest is history. And on that day in Spa in 2004, I remember it very well because Michael Schumacher was up on the media center roof, which is where we used to do the interviews. And it was a cool day like today. It wasn't wet particularly, but it was a cool day. And it was starting to get dark, and he was waving to all of his people, his fans underneath, celebrating seven. And we thought then that he'd probably go on and win eight, and then win nine again. The Ferrari was good. The 2004 was fantastic. We could see Fernando Alonso coming, but we could see that maybe seven wouldn't be the end, and Michael might go on to win some more. But, you know, he didn't, of course, and the rest is history. But with Lewis Hamilton, I get the feeling that he will go on after seven today to win eight, and then maybe even nine. But we're going to do things a little bit differently today. We're going to start at Williams and then end up at Mercedes, because that's where Lewis is going to be. We might stop halfway through for Simon talk to Lewis himself, and then we'll continue. But let's start at Williams, as we see the rather strange dance of the Turkish ambulances here, as they all need to reverse for some reason for everybody to get in. But they have put on a marvelous race, and it was, well, despite the track, despite old Slippery McSlipface, as I called it, in the middle of the race, being a little bit determining of what was happening, it meant that we saw a rather masterclass in how to deal with a car that was not necessarily the quickest today. And that's a sort of open question. Was the Mercedes-Benz the quickest car today, even though Lewis Hamilton won the race? I think you could argue that maybe even the Racing Point or even the Red Bull Racing car was the quickest car today. But you could also argue that the Mercedes was, of course, the quickest car. And it's not just the equipment, it's what you do with it, which we'll talk a little bit about later when we talk about Hamilton's achievement. Yes, it's all very well and good to have the fastest car, allowing you to win these world championships, but it's what you do with it that counts. But let's talk about Williams, who is clearly, sadly for them, not the quickest car today. George Russell was 16th, and Nicholas Latifi had a DNF. So both started on intermediate tyres. Nicholas Latifi stopped very strangely on lap 10 onto new intermediates, even though he was already on supposedly the right tyre, because he couldn't get tyre temperature into the tyres. So he rejoined and was racing the Haas drivers as they normally do. He clashed with Romain Grosjean, picked up damage to his car after that, and they had to pit Latifi to retire him because his car was too badly damaged. As for George Russell, a sort of encouraging early stint. He was running as high as P11, but couldn't get the tyres working all afternoon, all race, really. He dropped back after running as high as P11 and in the end came home to finish in P16. So not particularly great for George Russell today. We're just letting the Mercedes engine palette to come out, return to Mercedes AMG team, Operations Centre, Brackley, Northamptonshire. Actually, that's not going to be that. That's going to be some other stuff, isn't it? And there, just to explain what's going on with this, a lot of this is going to Bahrain. And this is why the race trucks are not in the other side of the paddock, even though the hospitality trucks were able to come on a boat from the east coast of Italy down into for a couple of days, 3 days on a boat into the Turkish port of Pendik, and then just drive up here. Hospitality units we don't need again, but we do need all this equipment to go straight to Bahrain. So there wasn't any point in having the race trucks come here. That's why you can see everything, a lot of stuff is being flown straight. This is effectively a flyaway race. It's being flown straight to Bahrain, where we go reconvene in a couple of weeks' time. Right, Haas, let's do that. DNF all round, and double DNF, so not a good day for Haas F1. Kevin Magnussen with some great opening laps. He was running in P9, it all looked so good. and he pitted on lap 9. It was a great defence then that he was mounting. He was in P10 with a great defensive drive. He was sort of holding up, let's be honest about it, George Russell, Lando Norris, Kimi Raikkonen and Pierre Gasly, which was good for him, not so good for those cars behind him, but then had a horror pit stop where I can tell you that it confirmed was a left rear tyre. The wheel nut was cross-threaded, and so he was released. They realized that it was an unsafe release. They told him to stop, 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 and he stopped on the grass just down there on the pit exit. That's where Kevin Magnussen stopped. They wheeled him back. They undid the cross-threaded wheel nut and got him going again, but then later retired him. Romain Grosjean also pitted onto the intermediates on lap 9. He went long, pitted again on lap 38. That was a slow stop too, and then had an off on lap 49 and retired after the accident damage with the aforementioned Nicholas Latifi. So that's why Grosjean retired. So not a good day for Haas F1. Still waiting for that driver announcement as the dance of the ambulances have their little let's put on our sirens to celebrate a successful race thing going on. Don't worry, there's nothing bad happening. They just have a thing that they do. Good. Right, Kimi Raikkonen and Giovinazzi. Antonio Giovinazzi didn't have a very good day. Let's start with Giovinazzi. A horrendous day after a great qualifying. He spun on the formation lap and broke the front wing. He managed to get himself to the grid where they fixed the front wing, cleaned up the car and got him going, but then he rather squandered that second opportunity he'd been given. He started and conked out with a gearbox problem. They believe it's a gearbox problem and not an electrics problem as was initially thought. As for Kimi Raikkonen, you know, he kind of wanted it to be a fully wet race. He was nowhere really on the intermediate tyre. Wasn't really working for him. Full wet would have been great. They thought the Alfa Sauber was actually quite a good car in the full wet, but in the Inters, it was sort of neither here nor there. And on the intermediate tyre, Kimi couldn't really do anything. It was a good opening stint. He went to new intermediates on lap 32, but the tyres wouldn't really last after 10 laps of sort of hard work by Raikkonen. And after 10 laps, they were pretty much destroyed, the intermediates. So it wasn't really, it seems that they set their car up with toe and camber to actually properly heat up the tyres. And it was a little bit too much for the intermediate tyres today as Sauber celebrate their 500th race in Formula One, having started in 1993, of course, with Heinz Harald Frentzen and Carl Wendlinger, wasn't it? Right, so the Pink Panthers and poor Lance. There's only one thing you can say about it. Poor Lance. He was holding it together so beautifully, having started on pole position. A great start for Lance Stroll after Max Verstappen had a bad start. A very short hold on the lights, by the way, wasn't it? Really comfortable, looked totally comfortable in the first stint. Was just happy on the tyres that he was on. They were talking about slicks, but it wasn't the right thing to do. But then they got sort of spooked. They saw the likes of Leclerc trying new Inters, and that was a good idea, they thought. But then when he pitted for new Inters, Lance Stroll, that was the end of his race. The tyres grained up after that, and it was a real, real letdown. Really struggled after that, and was passed by Max Verstappen, and ended up dropping down to P9 with no pace on new intermediates, or less pace on new intermediates in a drying track than he had on proper full wets on a massively wet track. So really, really odd. Lance Stroll rightly should feel really disappointed and frustrated, because he did all the hard work in qualifying and it just didn't come together for him. But I suppose it will be a learning experience. But it did come together very nicely indeed for Sergio Perez. Great drive, P2 on the podium. Brilliant drive, got a good start on the grippy right-hand side of the grid, held P2 behind his teammate, got P1 when Lance pitted for a second time, got overtaken by Lewis Hamilton, there wasn't much he could do about that, hung on to P2 despite immense pressure from the Ferraris behind. I guess if Lance Stroll hadn't stopped and was happy to look after his tyres, as it seems that he was cooling them on this side of the grid, it seems Lance would have finished probably third or fourth, doing the same sort of strategy on the worn intermediates, running them from an early stop as soon as he put them on for 45 old laps, as Checo Perez did. Lance surely would have finished third or fourth, maybe with a reward for something else. So it's really unfortunate that he has for that. But good for Checo Perez and good points for the Pink Panthers. Right, Pierre Gasly and AlphaTauri. Weird one today, really, because, well, let's start with what happened with the engine change that meant that Pierre Gasly had to start from the back of the grid. So Pierre Gasly eventually, do you remember he had that battery fire in a couple of races ago and the car sort of lunched itself, well, torched itself more like. They will need to take a new engine and get an engine penalty at some time soon. They thought about, because qualifying wasn't so good for them, they might as well do it after qualifying here and it would be sort of lessened. But then they sort of changed their mind halfway through and they saw other people getting penalties for yellow flag infringements and such like. They thought, okay, well, maybe we won't do it. But it was too late by then. They're already halfway through the change. The FIA kind of didn't really look very kindly on this kind of, slightly messing them about and punted poor Pierre Gasly to the back of the grid. So that explains what happened there. Franz Tost, the team boss here at AlphaTauri, kind of accepts it, but isn't particularly happy with the way it all shook out. Danny Kvyat, really not getting anything at the moment. He pitted on lap 9, but the inters weren't working for him at all. In the dry, actually, they were looking much better than in the wet. So that was the issue for AlphaTauri. Had it stayed dry, actually, I think they would have been one of the teams that were able to turn their tyres on and get some heat into their tyres quite nicely. But as soon as it turned wet, they were kind of nowhere. Gasly started at the back of the grid due to the reason we said. He had eventual change onto the inters, but struggled with the tyres after that. And it just didn't work for Danny Kvyat either. So Kvyat 12th, getting the better of Gasly, and Gasly 13th, but by just one point. Right, we might as well do Renault. And then I think we do we need to take a break in the middle of this? Not quite sure. We do normally. So let's do Renault. And then we'll try and take a break with just a couple of minutes on Renault, because there's not much to see, because hopefully they put the screens up. Daniel Ricciardo 10th, Esteban Ocon 11th. So they've scored 1 point, which is not a great return for their hard work this week, because Daniel Ricciardo had a good start. He dropped down. No, he did, didn't he? He had a bad start. He dropped down 2 places from the start, which wasn't good for him. Esteban Ocon had to pit on lap 2 for new intermediates because he had a puncture. And then had to stop again later for the... he stopped for new full wet because he had a puncture. And then Ocon had to stop for the new intermediates later. So that really punted Ocon down the order. Ricciardo got overtaken by Sainz. He pitted again. And that was really a killer, just pitting that second time for Daniel Ricciardo, only P10. Ocon drifted home P11. Right, like the screen's up, we only have 4 more teams to do. McLaren, Red Bull, Ferrari and Mercedes. We've got a lot to say, so let's take a break and more notebook in a bit. Hiya, welcome back to the notebook for the 2020 Turkish Grand Prix. Now, if you're watching us live, that was nice with Lewis Hamilton, wasn't it? If you're watching us on the repeat and the edited of the notebook online or anything else, you won't know what I'm talking about. But go and check back at the end of the race show, because Lewis Hamilton was just talking to Karun and Simon, and that was all good. We'll just recap what he did. But we were halfway through, weren't we? And we were going to talk about McLaren, the team, of course, that Lewis won his first World Championship for back in 2008. And not a bad day for them after picking up a penalty each for Sainz for impeding and Norris for ignoring yellow flags in qualifying, which was a real body blow to the team. They picked themselves up on race day and delivered both cars in the points, and that's very, very solid work. Sainz P5, Lando P8 from lowly grid positions, and a mega start from Carlos Sainz, as always, up to P9. He did a later stop onto the intermediates, then ran behind Daniel Ricciardo. He got passed by Ricciardo on lap 33 for P6, but then he inherited P5. He got past Ricciardo for P6, I should say. He overtook the Renault and then then inherited P5 when Max Verstappen stopped for a second time. So that's how Sainz got up to P5, and he stayed there. So very, very good work for Carlos Sainz. Great drive from him. Lando Norris, not so bad. He stopped onto the intermediates on lap 10 and then was stuck behind Kevin Magnussen. It was Lando who was stuck in the Danish I can't believe I can't get past you, Kevin Magnussen Haas train. But eventually he got past, and that was crucial. Yes, it was a bit later than Lando would have liked, but still, at least he got past him. And then eventually he got past him on lap 29. Then he got into P10. Then he got past Ricciardo and P. Stroll for P8. So very solid work for Lando Nozzo Norris, who's wearing that nice grey hat with the bright green bobble on the top of it. Now, Max Verstappen. I have not at the moment any information from the stewards. As we do this, they haven't said whether he's going to get a penalty, any kind of penalty for crossing the white line on the pit exit on his second stop. But that would sort of sum up his day, really, wouldn't it? Because, yes, they might have had one of the fastest cars at Red Bull Racing celebrating their 300th race start. But from circumstance and spins and a nervous car, they ended up with pretty much nothing. That's not true, of course. Max Verstappen was sixth and Alex Albon was seventh. So there's not so bad points, but that's not what Red Bull Racing came to the circuit for at all. And it was the worst start ever for Max Verstappen. Went absolutely nowhere. Nowhere. He went backwards. Recovered from the mid-grid after that, but really got stuck behind Sebastian Vettel while the racing points were getting away, and eventually got past Vettel. But then... Alex Albon, meanwhile, missed the virtual safety car by a couple of laps. He was running P6. Max Verstappen then got behind Sergio Perez, made a mistake, and spun down to P8. And Alex Albon then spun down to P4. So there were spinners all over the place. You know, it was just a mess. They stopped, both of them stopped again on the intermediates because of the spins, because the car rear of the car was just a bit nervous and they weren't managing to get hold of it, and the second stop really did for both Red Bull Racings, trundling home seventh and sixth. So not a good end to their 300th Grand Prix, but a good end to the weekend for Sebastian Vettel, and that was nice, wasn't it? That was part of the feel-good podium with Checo Perez and Seb Vettel, I think for the first time, certainly since the end, tail end of last year, and maybe even from... Was it Japan? When was the last time he was on the podium? Certainly the end of last year. No, it might have been even his win in Singapore. But anyway, that was a great fight, a great spirited drive from Seb Vettel for the podium. Great start for Seb, up to P3, holding off Max Verstappen. Got overtaken by Verstappen after the pit stops, and then got overtaken by Alex Albon, but held off Lewis Hamilton for quite a while. Pulled away from Hamilton for a bit while Hamilton was understanding what was going on with his tyres and with his car. But eventually Hamilton got by. Seb was very quick towards the end. Charles, as it happened, pitted for Inters on lap 7. So Charles was Mr. Let's give it a go with the tyres today. So he was the earliest to pit off the full wets onto the Inters, was very quick, made up a lot of places, ran very well. Then he was the first to decide, right, these Inters have had enough. Let's try new Inters on lap 31 before anybody else. And that was what set in train lots of other people thinking, oh, this is a good idea. Let's try the new intermediates. Case in point, Lance Stroll wasn't the right decision for Lance Stroll, as we've already said, but it was the right decision for Charles Leclerc. He got past his teammate and would have had a podium. But then a late trying to overtake Sergio Perez didn't work, and then Charles Leclerc dropped behind Sebastian Vettel, threw away the podium, was absolutely furious with himself, Charles Leclerc. He's called himself an idiot, although in rather more colourful language. And he was being comforted by his team in Parc Fermé afterwards. They were really wanted to comfort him. Well, he was pretty much disconsolate, was crying after the race, but was dejected and was comforted by his team, whereas Sebastian Vettel kind of inherited it. And I expected Vettel, by the way, with the Mexican flag above his the head on the podium. He's not Mexican, despite the moustache that he grew last year and the sombreros when he was on the podium in Mexico City. That was just a mix-up between Sergio Perez, you know what I mean. I expected Vettel to be a bit more happy because, you know, this does sort of set him up nicely for the Aston Martin. You know, Seb's got a bit of confidence back. Maybe this will give him a bit of confidence. You know, he'll feel happy about that. But I think he knows, he's brutally honest with himself, Sebastian Vettel, he will know that Leclerc overtook him for third today and would have finished third had Leclerc not thrown it away. So I think that's why Seb didn't feel particularly happy about it, although he should do. And also, I just noticed something. I just observed this, just an observation from my point of view. While Charles was more warmly comforted by the Ferrari mechanics than Seb was for being P3. And I thought that was odd. Well, I don't suppose it should be. We know that the Sebastian Vettel-Ferrari love affair is well and truly over. The divorce is very much through the law courts, and metaphorically speaking, and they're almost, you know, going to get their split at the end. But it seems to be sort of spluttering to a sort of, well, rather sad end, the Ferrari-Sebastian Vettel relationship with... you know, for many, many, many reasons. Right. And which leads us, but he's got a podium for them today, which is good. Which leaves us with the world champions and an outstanding drive for Lewis Hamilton. Let's do the race first. Lewis Hamilton first, Valtteri Bottas 14th. Oi, what happened there? And a good start from Lewis Hamilton, held P6. Remember, he was only P6 on the grid. Stopped for inters on lap 9, struggled with the brakes, but eventually got them going. Got overtaken by Alex Albon and then went on to the intermediates around the sort of midpoint of when people were doing it. It was around sort of lap 15, I think, and then stayed there more or less, overruled, but worked his way up as the Red Bulls pitted again and others came to grief and actually inherited the lead and absolutely stayed there. And overruled Mercedes towards the end for the safety stop. He'd learnt from... What's that? No action towards Max. No further action. Thank you. I'm being told something. No further action towards Max Verstappen about the white line on the exit. Yes, he ignored the call for the safety stop, having learned from the Chinese incident in 2007 when he spun coming into the pit lane and lost the 2007 World Championship that way. And he said it wasn't going to do that again, and stayed on the tyres and finished brilliantly in first place. Valtteri Bottas spun on lap 1, then he spun again later on. He was down to 18th, got totally stuck behind a load of cars, pitted for inters on lap 8, had another spin for P17, and was just a miserable way to end a miserable day. He said finished 14th. He said that it was in the end... he wasn't as, you know, good enough to beat Lewis Hamilton this year. And it takes me back to that time we went to Nastola with Valtteri Bottas when he just joined Mercedes. I said to him, look, you just have to, you know, you will just have to accept sometimes that Lewis Hamilton is unbeatable. And Valtteri said, no, I don't think that way. If I think that way, I, you know, shouldn't drive for this team. Well, he's found out since that on some days and in some years, Lewis Hamilton is just unbeatable. That's just the way it is. But that doesn't mean that Valtteri Bottas won't continue and give it a go next year, as he confirmed, which is nice. Just a final few thoughts as the sun sets over downtown Istanbul on Mercedes. Lewis Hamilton, celebrating his 7th World Championship, has been absolutely, absolutely outstanding this year, hasn't he? Still he rises, and still he rises, as they say. I thought it was nice that him saying, you know, a sort of message to kids out there, to the dreamers, you know, do anything. You can do anything you want. He said, you've got to dream the impossible and speak it into existence, work it into existence. I thought it was a nice thought. And in a year like no other, his achievement is not to be underestimated. When you've had this year, when, yes, they tested the W11, it was all looking good. They went to Melbourne and it was all looking great. To have the COVID lockdowns and then to be having to sort of go down into that area where, you know, he wasn't surrounded by his team, to deal with that and then to come back and having to, as he's already spoken about, to keep himself not being able to go out and do whatever he wants and to having to keep himself in a bubble because of, you know, the having to be in that to carry on and not get COVID, which would have really truly been the end of his championship for all of these drivers. It's just been a year like no other, and a shortened year as well. We've got fewer races, of course, and every race has counted. And Lewis has been impeccable. He's been extraordinary, and he's been almost perfect in this car. So it's been very, very impressive. Lots of things that he said in the press conference that I'm sure you'll read in your newspapers, but some very heartfelt stuff as well about what you can accomplish And what was the other things he was saying? I thought I might tell you. Oh yeah, about whether it's easy for him to win when he's in the best car. He says, well, of course you have to have the equipment, but it's what you do with it. And told a nice story about when he was karting, and Jensen's dad, John Button, had the rocket engines, the good karting engines that him and that Lewis and his dad Anthony couldn't afford. And when he got one of the engines, then he was winning lots of things. But he was still successful in his little kart with the old engine, the old knackered engine. Just to show that he could win without it as well. But Lewis really is sort of breaking down barriers, and paid credit to his dad as well. He paid credit to his brother, and of course his brother Nick Hamilton is also sort of redefining what differently abled drivers can do in racing cars as well, with going great guns in British Touring Car Championship. Nick Hamilton, isn't he? So Anthony Hamilton and his wife Linda have lots to be proud of, and Lewis Hamilton has lots to be proud of today as well. Right, that's about it for the notebook, I think. There was so much more to say about Lewis Hamilton, but we will have Bahrain and Abu Dhabi to talk about that before 2020 is over. I think I'll be in Bahrain and Abu Dhabi. You never know what's going to happen with the old COVID stuff, but I should be. The plan is to be there, but those plans might change. But in any case, Sky F1 will be there. The Bahrain Grand Prix from the Manama in a couple of weeks' time. So that's it from me. That's it from a very sort of cold weekend in Portugal. But we'll leave you with the thought that we have a 7-time world champion over there at Mercedes with Lewis Hamilton. And unlike Michael Schumacher on that day back in 2004 in Spa, I don't think this is the end of it. Do you? Bye-bye.
Sky Sports. Feel it all.